Hello, Internet, and welcome back to Anti-Heroes Anonymous. Welcome for the first time if it's your first time joining us. I'm Ethan, and I'm the Dungeon Master for this 5th edition Dungeons & Dragons show! I will do some announcements and a recap, and then we'll get into tonight's session. But before that, Nick, would you like to kick off some player introductions?
Sure. Hi, I'm Nick. I play Sir Thaddeus Hammerlock, the Human Inventions Paladin.
And Kay, I play Harmony, who's the Tiefling Wild Magic Sorcerer.
I'm Zach, and I play Zant, who is a human fighter ranger.
I'm Melissa, and I play Mara, who is a human rogue swashbuckler.
So those announcements I was talking about, we premiere our episodes on YouTube every Monday at 7 p.m. Pacific time. Throughout the show, we use a variety of custom items, as well as a custom wild magic table, so be aware of that as you're watching. Our character portraits on the info cards that way?
Yes.
Yes. Nailed it. We're drawn by an artist named Carrie Peach, who goes by @CarrieDraws on Twitter. You can check the video descriptions for links and information to everything I just mentioned and more, including some links to Black Lives Matter resources. Also starting this week, we will have a link down there in the description to a site called World Anvil, which if you haven't heard of it, is a website that helps people who build worlds for fictional things like we do here, kind of organize all their information. So what we've done is we've gone ahead and created kind of like a little Wikipedia about our world and our campaign and the characters in it. So if you need a refresher on anything that's going on in the campaign, or if you want to, you know, try and dig through it and find some fresh art for some NPCs that Kay has drawn, you can check out World Anvil there. Other than that, you can follow us on Twitter @AntiHeroesAnon. Hope you enjoy the show. Come back and share it with your friends. And one more thing on World Anvil, just because I remembered, we've been working on it for a while, and Kay's done a lot of art for various NPCs throughout it, but the best one is definitely Seal.
Be sure
to check out Seal's page because have some rockin' artwork. Okay, so a recap and then we'll get into it. The anti-heroes are going after Mother Midnight in her lair on Malbolg, the sixth lair of the Nine Hells. In addition to Malagard's forces, Malagard being the alternative name of Mother Midnight, in addition to her forces, the armies of Beelzebul and Mephistopheles also stand ready to oppose the anti-heroes. Moloch has some plans to turn the tides in the party's favor. And so far, to that end, they've enlisted the help of a archdevil named Ruin, who turned out to be related to Harmony in some distant way, and freed a captured Yugoloth spy who had valuable information. However, there's still much work to be done before the party has a chance at victory. So we will pick up today's session with the group of you. Harmony had just cast teleport, leaving behind the crater in which the Chain Devil Fortress was situated, launching the group of you through space across the plane.
I guess it's a Spine Devil Fortress now, huh?
Yeah, there's like one Spine Devil left when you were done. Some Maragons. Harmony's rainbow magic flared to life, surrounding all of you, encompassing you, and dragging you across the plane back to Moloch's camp. And as the rainbow light fades, you find yourselves standing outside of Moloch's battle tent again. However, the situation in the camp has changed a bit since last you were here. There's very few Yugoloths around, and from where you are, you can hear the sounds of battle off in the distance, far distance, but it is clear that the battle has started in full on the plains nearby. And replacing the Yugoloths in the camp, there are now, I don't want to say like legions, but there are huge numbers of new creatures that were not there before. There are ice devils that are completely clad in this like dark black armor and wielding wicked looking hellish weapons. And there are also kind of the ice devils are keeping their distance from this group, and this group is kind of chaotically thrashing about doing its own thing. But there are also another type of fiend that you have not seen before that are just kind of these like gaunt, like obsidian skin, the same sort of skin tone as Grotzt, obsidian skinned, humanoid looking creatures. They don't seem to have any, like they don't wear armor or anything like that. And they also seem to be like dripping with a black blood or ooze a little bit. But their most distinctive feature is, well, they have two, I guess. When you catch their eyes, there is not necessarily a feeling of, well, let me look them up real quick. Describe this best. Like it almost makes you feel weak, like your legs go a little jelly-like. Your arms kind of start to feel a little bit like you've just finished a long workout, that sort of thing. And then the other distinguishing feature that they have is they have this one curved horn on the top of their heads that just comes up in front of their foreheads. And I think Zant, who is well-versed in fiends, right? They're your favorite enemy.
Yes.
You at least, and probably Harmony as well, since Harmony has done so much research into devils, the two of you know that these creatures are not, in fact, devils.
But they are fiends?
They are fiends.
Oh, certainly. Weird.
Yeah. So that's the site when you return to the camp.
Huh.
What would you like to do?
Looks like Rhoad brought some friends with him from the Abyss.
Must be.
Yeah. Based on the way that they're behaving, they do seem demon-like rather than devil or Yugoloth, for sure.
It might be the upper hand that we need.
But they are, like, obeying to some degree?
Yeah. Yeah, I mean, they're not harming anyone in camp, which is probably, based on what you know about demons, a feat in and of itself, that someone could control them to that degree.
Hmm. Okay.
I'm glad that Rune is not our enemy.
Yeah.
And I'll go into Moloch's tent.
Yeah, I'll follow.
Yeah.
Okay. Moloch is in there, and pretty much as you'd expect, he is barking orders to some ice devils that are in there. They seem to be, they're also grouped with a couple of these weird looking demon creatures, but the demon creatures are not really listening to Moloch's orders. They're more like, just like randomly ambling around the tent while Moloch gives orders to the ice devils. And eventually, when Moloch catches your eye and finishes giving orders to this group, that group leaves, leaving you alone in the tent with Moloch.
And he says, a guest.
Ah, yeah, I see. So I take it this would be Tally then, huh?
Don't you recognize them?
Well, look.
They never met.
Got the scar.
Well, I know. It's more of a joke, yeah, because he was like trying to give us some weird, you know, ideas of what they looked like.
Does Tally have scars?
Yeah, Tally had some scars.
It's, okay.
Yeah. I mean, none of them are particularly distinctive, but... Yeah, so Moloch kind of looks at this and says, ah, so I told you he had scars.
Yeah. Zant just smiles a little bit.
And he kind of hops up on the table. His green helmet almost falls off and he has to put it back on his head. And he kind of walks across the table over to Tally and then says, all right, well, we rescued you. Went to a lot of work to do it. You have this bunch of people to thank for saving your butt. Now, what do you got for us? And Tally's voice telepathically kind of fills each of your heads. And he says, let me just pull open the document real quick so I make sure I get this right. Okay. He says, well, during my time behind enemy lines, I was able to infiltrate Mephistopheles' ranks to some degree and learn a bit of the arcane contraptions that the Archduke has brought up from his research facilities in Cania. It turns out one of these contraptions is a particularly deadly device. a device capable of unleashing a blast of force miles wide and devastating entire ranks of armies. And Moloch just kind of says, what, you mean like some kind of bomb? And Tali replies, yes, precisely. A force bomb of hitherto unknown magnitude.
Like, Moloch, they've never seen me shoot off a ninth level fireball before.
Your ninth level fireball doesn't have a radius that's miles wide, though.
I know.
Moloch kind of like gives you a nod, though, as you say that. Like, yeah, for sure. And he then kind of takes to contemplating and says, well, you're right that this is information that is useful. If we could obtain this device and use it for ourselves, or even if we can just get in and disarm it, render it useless so it can't be used against us, that seems like a significant victory. And then he looks up to the group of you, kind of looking to Harmony specifically for leadership, and says, is that something that the group of you would be interested in? I know there's lots of other objectives that would suit your skill set to a T. So if this isn't something you want to deal with, I can put some of my guys on it.
I think we talked about some other tasks that would probably be better suited for our specific skill set. So if you can find someone to take care of that.
Yeah, I mean, I've got people. It's, I guess, possible that the mission won't go quite as well without you. But look, there's only so many ways that we can utilize your talents due to the fact that your time and energies are limited. So that's fine. I'll put my people on it. Tali, you can go. And he kind of like looks at how Tali is all beat up and bruised. Maybe he's noticed that Tali is missing his tongue. And he says, you can go get some rest and see what you can do about those injuries, I guess. And Tali just kind of gives a shallow nod and walks out.
I'm curious, Moloch, if Tali were to die here, and when he reforms back in wherever he comes from, will he be whole again?
Probably.
It tallies up the score, huh?
Yeah, unfortunately, there may still be use for Tali, though, so I don't want to see the guy just get, you know, torn apart
here and now. Academic curiosity only.
Yes. I suppose I can understand that. It's just, you know, injured as he may be, as soon as he goes back there, you know, his obligation to me is gone, so use as much of his ability as I can, and then poof, when he's gone, he's gone. That's what I'm thinking.
Sounds good to us.
And Moloch kind of looks around at the group of you and then finally settles on Harmony and says, so, boss, you all look pretty tired. I'm assuming you're going to want to take some rest, but what's the plan?
We were talking about a few ways to spread chaos through the enemy ranks. You know, set a couple of officers against each other. But I looked over at the rest of you, and especially Thaddeus. I think we probably do need to rest first.
We do need to rest before we really get the plan put together, but I want to talk to you about it. I guess talk to everybody, just to get an idea of how the plan will work, or what we're going to do here, because it may have, I need to put up the temple for the four of us. It's hard for us to rest well outside of that temple, and where I put it may factor into our plan. So let me explain to you what we're thinking, Moloch.
Sure, hit me with it. What was the next thing on your list? Were you, you had mentioned you thought you might have some ideas for, you know, sewing kind of, you know, chaos and such in the ranks, but was that potentially by driving a wedge between the, you know, the two archdevil leaders, or
Did you have other ideas? What's the plan?
Well, I thought of it when you were telling me about the nature or the history of Beelzebul. He used to be a fallen angel himself, wasn't he?
Oh, yeah. Oh, yeah. Long time before Zariel. Back when the Nine Hells was young, because believe it or not, it wasn't always here. Let me just pull up his information here. Yeah, he was a celestial named Triel, or so they say. Mephistopheles was an archdevil back then as well. One of the oldest, really, by any reckoning. And so he remembers back when, you know, Beelzebul was Triel and never really got along with the guy.
What I want to do is set this work that angle. I want to send a messenger out to Beelzebul and offer him the same deal we gave Zariel, because he's got to be chafing under Asmodeus' rule just like he was. All the archdukes are, as far as I can understand. So we've got a proven track record that we can do this, which might be enticing. And at the same time, I would like to send a separate messenger to Mephistopheles' camp to warn him that Beelzebul is planning to meet with us and break ranks.
I see. So it's twofold, then, your attempt. Moloch kind of folds his arms and thinks for a second. He says, well, there are a couple things you need to consider as you're trying to lay out your specifics. Mm-hmm. First thing is, you need to know your enemies. Beelzebul, I've told you, it used to be a celestial, but that was a long time ago. And any shred of that former being is, well, it's well and truly purged. They don't come much more evil than Beelzebul. And furthermore, history is a little bit unclear how the transformation came about. Many suspect that Triel, back when he was Triel, not Beelzebul, sought out Asmodeus, and that it wasn't a fall so much as it was a bid for more power, which makes that lie a little bit harder to, sell to Mephistopheles, if that is the truth. I wasn't around at the time, so I don't know. The other thing we need to know, or the other thing you need to keep in mind, is that Mephistopheles is one of the greatest minds in the, not even just the Nine Hells, but the multiverse as a whole. One of the most powerful wizards and most intelligent beings in existence. A being like that is difficult to fool, but it's not impossible. It's been done before in the history of the Nine Hells. Mephistopheles has been double-crossed, so we just have to be careful about our methods.
He's not here though, is he, Mephistopheles?
Unlikely.
So it's not even really him we need to fool.
This is true, but he's put Hutagen in command, and Hutagen won't act on any bit of intelligence without conversing with his master. So while Mephistopheles, you know, is cooped up down in Cania in his research facilities and hates being bothered, Hutagen is one of those who is allowed, under any circumstances, to contact Mephistopheles. And he will for something like this, I'm sure. However, Mephistopheles does trust Hutagen. So, perhaps, depending on how you play it, if you can convince Hutagen 100%, then Mephistopheles may just take his opinion for it.
I don't know. This sounds like it might be a shakier plan than I had anticipated. Do you think this is worth going through with? And I look at the rest of the group.
Well, I do have certain spells that could help sell the story. I could even dominate Hutagen if it came to that and get him to go tell the story.
Otherwise, is there any other factors to why they hate each other? Like that we can play on and work that angle instead of a new prospect?
Good idea.
Well, there's a couple reasons. most of them are driven by Beelzebul. Like I said, the guy was originally a celestial, not one of the original devils like Mephistopheles. And so when Beelzebul started rising up through the ranks, it was at incredible speed, because if there's one thing that Triel strove for in everything, it was perfection. And Asmodeus admired that, and it showed in Beelzebul's results. The other thing Asmodeus liked about Beelzebul was he can spin a lie like there's no tomorrow. And I think Asmodeus admired his ability for deception. It rivals Asmodeus's, though I doubt any are quite as skilled as he. And so Mephistopheles saw Beelzebul rising through the ranks, not even a true devil. And this certainly irked him. And Beelzebul got to a point where he was approaching Mephistopheles' level of power. Obviously, he's the Archduke of the Seventh, and Mephistopheles is the Archduke of the Eighth. And in fact, at one point, Beelzebul had dominion over not one, but two layers of the Hells.
So I guess I can see maybe another option then. I'm okay. I mean, Thaddeus's plan, I think, is good. We could also try and maybe broach the subject of how there might be another promotion coming depending on how he favors in this war and work that as well. So then Mephistopheles might want to sabotage Beelzebub.
And maybe we could work the Zerial story, a different angle of it, or tell it different. Like, it happened not in the way that it actually happened. Like, we could say, we could approach Mephistopheles with this, like, information of another promotion. And also, you know, we can turn Beelzebul back into an angel.
Oh, like, forcefully?
And this is a way to get him out of hell, if you help
permanently,
us. And then
yeah.
We send another messenger to Beelzebul saying, Mephistopheles is plotting against you because there's a promotion coming up and you're going to get it.
I wonder if this might be a better angle to work with Hudogen. Because Hudogen, from what I understand from what you've told me, isn't an archduke. So Mephistopheles can't be promoted to archduke, because he already is. But if you could convince Hudogen that there's an archdukedom up for grabs with Beelzebul, that might be an angle here.
The strange thing about Hudogen is, for as long as anyone can remember, even though he probably has the following to stage potentially success, but potentially, and I say potentially with a big if on it, a potentially successful coup against Mephistopheles and take his archdukedom, he never has. So there's a little bit of mystery as to why that is, but he always has seemed, at least, loyal to Mephistopheles. Though, as with any devil, that's who knows how far that truly goes. The one other thing I will say about Beelzebul's story that might be of use is, I think you saw him back at the feast in Stygia. Big slug-looking guy. Beelzebul always liked perfection and beauty. Those were his things. And obviously he's not happy with his current form, which actually is a curse from Asmodeus back from an event called the Reckoning of Hell, which yours truly had a little bit of a hand in. And so Beelzebul is desperate to do anything to win back his previous form. And I think that extends to doing whatever he can to please Asmodeus in events such as this one.
So again, another way to alert him to our temple and to send the information to Hudogen that Beelzebul is trying to, you know, ally with the enemy in order to get his previous form back.
Yeah, you know, the more you're telling me this, the more I think a version of or variation of my original plan might work, because we don't need, if anyone would believe, whether or not it's likely to actually happen, if anyone would believe that Beelzebul was trying to get back to his life as Triel, it sounds like it would be Mephistopheles.
Potentially.
Who's always...
It's only because he wants to believe it.
Right, exactly.
He's just, like, looking for a reason, you think? To, you know...
Like I've said, I think that this deception is possible. It's going to be challenging, and there are roadblocks, but your idea, I think, in at its basic level, is sound.
How could we get an audience with Beelzebul in the middle of a war?
There are practices which can be observed. I can make it happen.
Well, right.
I mean, I can extend the invitation. It's going to be up to you to make it enticing, I think.
I think we can cover that. But what I'd like from you is a Yugoloth that you can afford to lose, the one who would have a reason to know what we're plotting here. Because I'd like to send this Yugoloth over to Hudigen's camp and have him fake defect, have him offer something he overheard in our camp for a price.
Moloch thinks, well, every Yugoloth here is, well, they're under my command, but their allegiances can be bought. So I think probably any Yugoloth would do, so long as we, you know, give them enough extra treasure to take on this extra dangerous mission. It could probably even be Tally.
I don't feel good about sending Tally back into the enemy territory.
Well, it's not much good as a spellcaster right now, so.
Oh.
Thank you for this rest.
Then again, sending Tally out on a dangerous mission might be the pretext we need to a good cover story for him to believably want to break ranks with your army.
The nice thing about the way Yugoloths work is we don't even need a reason for him to want to break ranks. Under ordinary circumstances, you know, a small amount of money would be enough. Well, small, relatively, compared to what the Archdukes have in their troves, anyways, would be enough to get a Yugoloth to break ranks.
So. I'm just thinking about what Hudigen is going to think when someone... He wouldn't believe a messenger. He would see through that ruse. Is all I'm trying to get at here.
Possibly. Well, if you want Tally, I can get Tally. If you want another Yugoloth, I can get another Yugoloth. These are things that I can do.
Maybe it's something Tally would want to do after he's got a little first aid and little rest.
Tally would be more trustworthy on our side because, you know, as far as I'm concerned, he still owes us.
That's a good point. I like the idea of Tally.
Tally's not going to think he owes you anything, so... If we want to do this, you should, offer him at least a little bit of money extra.
Well, if anything, he's seen all what the way back.
Was. Yeah, but he doesn't have anything to fear, does he? He dies here. He reforms back in his home plane.
That's not what I meant. I mean, he's seen that we can take out an entire chain devil prison, just us. So if he's going to gamble on which side's going to win...
Oh, that's what I'm saying, though. Tally, Yugoloths, they don't care which side wins here.
They're just straight mercenaries. They're in it for the money.
It means nothing to them.
We just need to pay him more, I think.
Moloch nods.
Do we have anything left?
do we need
to pay him?
We don't have to pay him. Right?
Well, I mean, I don't have any money.
Oh, okay.
Well, I think we would have to pay him because it's our plan.
Yeah.
How much do you think it would cost?
Does that mean we have to steal the treasure first?
We could do that. Oh, yeah, that would be...
Ooh.
Maybe, yeah.
Yeah. Yeah, maybe we table this until we have some discretionary funds.
Okay with that.
Well, I don't know that it would take a lot of money, but sure.
Well, what else were we thinking of doing?
Well, there was the hags are concerning. I look pointedly at Sans.
For what?
What happened to Ronan? That's on us.
Oh, sure.
Moloch looks a little bit thoughtful for a second before he looks to Harmony and Zant, since you were the two who were there, as far as he's aware. And he says, yeah, speaking of which, I realized in all my time hanging out with you guys, I never really asked, what was Malagard doing in Elendil? And what was her purpose?
I think she was breaking the rule of hags, right? She was like trying to form a new type of coven or something.
She formed a coven and she stole a child and birthed a new hag.
But she was increasing the number that they're supposed to have. Like it's supposed to be nine. Like three or something.
We there.
Whatever.
For more magic.
Yeah, Mara wasn't there, but we told Mara about it.
Oh yeah.
So she remembers.
She has really good notes.
Please help us because our memories are faulty.
Yeah, but she was trying to like break the code, basically. And she was using resources such as orphans and stuff and other devious ways to do that.
But she also seemed to have been expecting me.
Yeah.
She had that amulet around your neck ready for you. But
yes.
What was the purpose?
Maybe
I don't know if we ever found out.
That's troubling. Because I've seen that amulet do lots of things. And one of the things I've seen it do is tear open holes in space for those, you know, froggy aberrations to crawl through. And my sources are telling me that the hag's forces have those among them.
Yeah, I've had a little bit on my mind worry for that she's going to try and use that necklace against us somehow because it was hers originally.
I worry about that too.
Yeah, but we just don't know. Like, I can't say it's served Harmony without a fault because there's definitely times where we questioned it, but, you know, it's done more good than bad.
For the most part.
It's done more good than wrong, or right than wrong.
It makes my spells a lot more powerful, you guys.
That's just what we need. More chaos.
I just don't understand what she was doing. That's all.
Yeah. We don't really either.
I'm guessing she was just seeking power somehow, trying to overthrow something or building up.
What were you going to ask, Kay?
What do you know about what the hags are doing here, at least?
Not much. Malagard's laired up, you know, in a place that is guarded pretty much at the thickest part of the enemy forces. There's really no getting to it. I don't know. Like, look around. Malagard's dead, but obviously she's still acting across the plains. I mean, she was powerful, so I'm not surprised. But
that's something I wasn't clear on. Did this explosion happen before the two of you encountered her in Elendil?
This happened a long, long time ago.
Yeah.
Strange.
During the Reckoning of Hell, when I was put in this form, and he kind of gestures at his imp form, Malagard was my advisor. And she advised me wrongly and stupidly. And now it seems so obvious in retrospect. I can see that she was manipulating me for her own gain, but she advised me to stand up against Asmodeus and not surrender with the rest of the Archdukes,
Beelzebul had already defected and accepted his punishment. It was just me. And Malagard told me that Asmodeus would respect it if I stood my ground. And so I did. But he did not, obviously. And he gave my lair to Malagard. And then sometime after that, and then Glastia. So it's been a while. She's been like this for a while.
But she's not dead.
Yeah, at least not fully.
She's obviously planning something.
She's always been a tricky one. I mean, for a hag to plot her way up to becoming an archduke for any length of time, short-lived as it was, that's something. And I just feel if whatever she was doing in Elendil, whatever she did with this Ronin, and whatever purpose she had behind giving you the amulet, there's something more to it, and I'm worried about it.
Maybe we can find out what it was if we encounter these hags.
That's kind of what I'm hoping.
And Moloch kind of goes over to the section of the table where there's, a couple like purple figures arrayed on there. And he points there and says, well, this is where they are. They're not far. They're protected by some sort of dome of magical power. No one can get to them. And they're working a ritual in there that's making groups of fiends that they're protecting immune to pain, and it's making them downright hard to kill. You know, you put a little pain in a devil on the nine hells and they are gonna wanna flee because they die here, they're dead for good, but these ones are fighting well past their capacity. And this bubble, it's guarded by these, you know, these abominations that we've seen come through the portal that your amulet can open. So, getting to it's been a bit tough. But I think maybe with your elephant, maybe you could just drop in. I don't know.
I was wondering if it goes underground.
Moloch kind of shrugs.
Too bad we didn't steal Mercer's airship. another method.
Well, we don't have access to the elephant yet, so that brings us back to the topic of rest.
Yeah, we were going to rest regardless.
So does where you rest matter for your plan?
Not right now. Not right now.
We should still rest in the temple, though, right?
We should.
Yeah.
But I was thinking if I needed to put the temple in a place where Beelzebul wouldn't feel threatened coming to it, then we would need to talk about where that was. But now it doesn't matter that much.
I see. Okay.
So I'm just going to... That is just going to go outside and look for a spot that would hold his temple.
Okay. The camp is kind of nestled in like a... like a little bit of a... like a cove in a mountainside. It's the like nostril mountainside that you climbed out of much earlier. So you'd probably have to kind of go out of the camp a little ways and kind of around the side of the mountainside a bit.
Okay.
Otherwise, towards the battlefield. Those are kind of your two options.
Yeah, I think I'll go around and toward and off to the side a bit and start casting.
Okay. How long does that take again?
An hour.
An hour. Okay. Is there anything anyone else wants to do in the hour that you have? Or anything you want to talk about amongst yourselves? Kay's got something.
I'll stay behind with Moloch if everyone else leaves. And I'll tell them, like, I'll catch up.
All right, we'll be a noses blow away, and I walk out.
Okay, I'll look for Pinky and feed him and train him a bit, I guess.
Are you trying to train him to do anything in particular?
No, just our usual routine to keep everything fresh is what I mean.
Okay.
Not anything new.
I mean, Pinky's very intelligent. So, I mean, it's like working with a person, right?
So. Yeah. He gets
you
me.
Can't just give like simple sit, drop, stay commands. It's a little bit more than that. But yeah, okay. As long as you feed Pinky, he's quite happy.
Okay. So we'll just commune.
Mara, enter rats. Anything from Zant?
I was thinking about talking to Byakko for a little bit.
Sure. We can take care of that real quick.
Sure. Cast Speak with Moloch Animals. Voice. And
what is it, my master?
You did very good back there. We're going to be up against more and more difficult foes as we progress in this, though, so.
Byakko nods and says, yes, that has been the trend since I've been with you.
I'm sorry. I don't mean to put you in such danger.
Pay no mind. I have many lives yet to live, and...
Let's not spare another one.
Well, I was going to say, so far, these ones have been enjoyable. And he kind of purrs and, like, rubs up against you a little bit.
Yeah, and I'll pet him.
I've seen many things that spirits don't often get to see, though perhaps that will change in the future.
Well, we're honored to have you with us. And if you have anything on your mind or any guidance for us, I mean, we would like to hear it.
Byakko kind of, sits down and his tail kind of twitches back and forth for a minute.
It doesn't have to be right now. But, if...
I mean, it looks like he's seriously thinking about if he has any advice to share with you while he has, the opportunity because you've cast the spell. And he says... A mighty hunter must know their prey better than the prey knows itself. Otherwise, the prey will elude the hunter. In general, I think you do this, but there are many things we don't know right now.
Yeah, I think we also need some more information as well.
We just must be on our guard.
If you want to speak like this more, then I'll like maybe just say, just do this, and I'll have him like, I'll show him what to do, or maybe he'll like tug at my leg or something, and then I can cast a spell later if you... Okay. Anything.
I mean, he kind of gives you a smile, like a tigery smile, and says, in general, I am content to my quiet.
I understand.
Though it is nice once in a while.
Once in a while, yeah. Sure. Well, let's go see how Thaddeus is doing then, shall we?
Of course. And Byakko kind of pads at your side over to Thaddeus.
Yeah.
Then Harmony. You're left alone in Moloch's tent, and he kind of looks up at you and says, what's up, boss?
Are we alone, or are there other, chain devils or ice devils or whatever still hanging out?
There are probably some guards outside the tent, but in general, when you're interacting with Moloch, he tends to shoo everyone away.
All right.
So that it's just the group of you.
Then I'll just pull myself up to sit on the map table and look at him and just say, this is a lot. Are you okay?
Roll an insight check.
Okay. Ooh, not bad. I believe. 18.
All right. He says, well, I mean, yes and no. Look, it is a lot, right? I mean, I knew... was bringing the army down. We were gonna oust Malagard. We were gonna get revenge.
And then, look, I wanted to be able to stick around the Hells. I wanted to be done with material planes. But now, I don't know. I'm not sure how the boss man's going to take this, but like, we've come this far, so.
So yeah. You don't know what comes next.
No, I know that I feel like this feels a lot like last time. Everything inside me is saying, back down. Asmodeus isn't going to let you unscathed, and then
we're not taking on Asmodeus, though. I mean, his armies are sent against us, but they're not our real targets, right?
No, they're not. But it feels a lot like last time. It was here. There was my army. There was Asmodeus's army, and my council was saying, stay and fight. You guys are saying, stay and fight. And everything inside me is saying, run.
As he's talking, I'm casting Mage Hand to just like rub his back, like soothingly.
He's like twitching his wings, like a little annoyed by it.
I'm sorry that this is the situation. It was your idea to come down here.
Yeah.
But it wasn't your fault that this is happening.
It was not my idea to go and try and redeem Zeriel.
Yeah, that wasn't my idea either, to be fair. Listen,
it would have been so much easier if it weren't for Thaddeus. I understand he's an asset to your group, and yeah.
Malik, I need you to come with us when we leave this place. I need you to come back with us.
His eyes kind of narrow at you, and he says, what? Why? I mean, boss, this is the end of our deal.
I know.
I know it's been fun. It has been. It's been delightful, but this is my home.
I know. And I'm not asking for your help anymore. But if you stay here, I'm afraid that you're not going to survive.
What does that mean?
Thaddeus made a deal.
His eyes start to narrow.
With Glossia. And if you stay here, your life is in danger because of it. But if you come with us, we might be able to find a loophole.
His eyes are narrowed, and you can see that his little claws are balled up in tight fists, and he's thinking, and he says, I really hate that guy.
I know. He hates you too.
I get it. Like, we're not meant to like each other. We're just different creatures. But it's more than other paladins. I've met lots of paladins, but something about Thaddeus just, ugh.
I know, but if you come back to the material plane with us, you don't even have to stay with us. And maybe then it can be part of Thaddeus's life mission to hunt you down, but at least if something happens to you there, you're not going to be dead forever. You know?
And he looks at you and says,
but I worked so hard to get here.
I know.
Make a persuasion check at disadvantage.
Can I use Tides of Chaos to make it a straight roll?
Yeah, sure.
Okay, all right. Yeah,
26. 26? Okay. He looks at you. His eyes are still narrowed with anger. Also, you can see the doubt at like what he's currently doing, like the entire current situation, and he just says, "I'll think about it."
Look, that's all I ask. And if you come back with us and if we survive everything, we might be able to find another solution and I might be able to help you more. I want the future to be a possibility for you. I don't want your story to end here with this war.
Yeah, he says, maybe it would, maybe it wouldn't. I'll think about it.
And I'm sorry. I'll just get up.
Usually when you sort of end a conversation with Moloch or whatever, he'll kind of give you a little kind of cheeky, like, see you later, boss, or like, rest up, boss, or something like that. But he just kind of like doesn't even look at you, kind of turns his back on you as you walk out the tent.
Okay. Yeah. And I'll just really take my time heading to the temple, like checking out the camp, seeing what kind of devils are here, really taking my time because I'm not ready yet.
Yeah, I mean, like I said, there's these ice devils that are like heavily armored in like dark black armor. And all of them kind of seem to be ignoring you for the most part. But the demons who are under Ruin's control, who you saw earlier, the ones with like the weird curled horn, they seem to like take an interest in you to some extent. None of them like attack you or anything like that. But whenever you pass by a group of them, it's like every single one of their attention goes to you. And it's very
to me slight, or to the amulet?
To you. And it's very slight, but like you feel something you felt several times at this point when you've encountered people or things that are sort of connected to your bloodline. You feel that kind of like the amulet tugs up a little bit in their direction and there's a little bit of a magnetic pole there or like electricity kind of building between the two of you. It's a little weird because they are these kind of like gross, like slobbering brute type creatures, but there is a little bit of that.
Do I remember if I also felt like this when we were fighting Mother Midnight?
Oh, like you felt a like some kind of draw to her? No, you didn't feel like your bloodline was like drawing you towards her or anything like that. No. When she produced the amulet, it was like, you remember it kind of like snapped to you and was like making your magic go crazy. But yeah, there was none of that connection to her. The only thing that you felt the connection to in that fight was the amulet itself.
Okay. Then I'm going to go back to our group. I'm going to pretty much, I know that it's going to take an hour, so I think I'll pretty much take the whole hour wandering and get there just as he's finishing the spell. And I'm going to collect Mara and Zant and like hook my arms in and say, I could go for some really good food right now. How about you guys?
Sure. Here? But everything down here tastes terrible.
Maybe not once we're in the temple and maybe not with a little bit of magic.
Ah, that sounds great.
Come on.
All right.
We'll go inside the temple and...
Do we have any more of that special little ale that we found?
Oh, I can make ale.
Somewhere.
I can make ale. And I'm going to sit crisscross applesauce on the floor of the temple. And I'm going to cast Wish. And I'm going to say, I wish that we can feast like heroes tonight to prepare for our battle ahead. And I'm going to cast Heroes Feast. With Wish.
Wow.
So as the spell kind of happens, which I assume you're gonna let it happen, Mr. DM.
yeah, because with Wish you can ignore any material requirements.
Components.
Wow. I'm looking up the spell Heroes Feast and I apparently spelled it wrong, but one of the suggestions was Heroes Feet.
Why is that a suggestion?
Like feet, like in the appendage, or feet like feet?
As in like...
Did you mean hero's feet?
Great.
Did you mean hero's feet? Yeah, D&D Beyond. I meant hero's feet.
Were you asking about the ale that we had in the other campaign? Because we had...
No, there was something that we were going to bring home.
Harmony always has.
Well, you said special. No,
it was down here in one of the taverns, and we said, "Oh, we got to take some home to that."
That's
his
right,
name? Rick? The bartender. Mm. Yeah, Rick. We got to take some of this home to Rick.
Some was from the bar on Stygia. Yeah.
Oh yeah.
When we first got here, yeah, I don't remember what it was called though.
So I'm
it was
basically
the Styx thing.
Yeah, we all loved it.
Styx ale or something like that.
Yeah. Okay.
Yeah, so I'm going to sit crisscross applesauce on the floor, and I cast the spell, and it takes 10 minutes, but the magic, rainbow magic with black, I guess, is swirling around and creating, like, this table with this very decadent, like, velvet red and gold tablecloth and, like, candelabras with, like, fire that changes color on the candles, and it's got, like, giant platters of like the best of Elendil, similar to probably what we had at the ball at the capital. Just, you know, like meats and cheeses and breads and of
great
course
stuff.
Like giant bottles of just wine and champagne and just all the best things for everybody. And even like there's part of the table, it has some Elderhaven Reaches cuisine.
That's where I am.
For Zant. And yeah, a little bit of like seafood from Mara and just everything you could possibly want.
Cat food.
Yeah, well, I figured Biako can eat whatever Biako wants to eat.
Fish and stuff, yeah.
All right,
yeah,
let's
chat
out.
Biako is definitely eyeing some of the fish.
Oh, he gets whatever he wants.
Who is Thaddeus?
Yeah, there's
giant
lots of fish.
Lobster.
I remember that is asking
butter.
For fish.
Yeah.
And I rolled a 1, so wild magic also triggers.
Nice.
Oh, fantastic.
Wreck this temple.
Here we
Let's
go.
See what happens.
Hero's
no.
feet.
If it is just all feet.
Yeah, her feet matters. Just grow.
It starts raining feet in a 1-mile radius.
Oh, no.
That's
such a...
I rolled a 51 or a 56. How does that happen? okay, what 51 would be really funny. But also 56 is very thematic, so I can't choose.
Do you want me to roll randomly?
Or just
between
pick
the
one.
Two?
Between the two. You know, I want them both to happen. Okay, let's do 51.
Okay. Great. Harmony casts her spell, and this table, this majestic table appears. And before all of you can rush to devour the food that was conjured there, there's another like hiccup of rainbow magic that lashes out towards the table.
Should I roll the d4? Did you already do that?
Oh, I haven't, but you go for it. Tell me what you get.
Two.
Two, okay. Let me pull something up here. The magic lashes out towards the table, and there's a flash, but initially it doesn't seem like anything happens. But then Mara, Pinky's brain cavities begin to glow brightly. Like they always kind of emit a dim light, but they begin to glow brightly. And swarms of rats emerge from underneath the tablecloth and just begin swarming up towards your food. And you can just hear this psychic, food, 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 food.
Do we have to roll initiative now?
I mean, if you want to save your food, roll initiative.
Oh, no.
Oh, my God.
All right. We're saving the food.
Wait, swarms? Hold on.
Oh, no. Oh, you're right. Sorry.
It's only two.
Okay, sorry. I thought there were swarms. Okay, my bad.
No. Two. If it was swarms, I would not have chosen it.
Sorry, my bad. I could have sworn I read the word swarm there.
It's really wild to be swarms.
So, yeah, it's actually just two cranium rats, like one on either side of the table, begin running up towards the food.
So we don't have to roll initiative.
You don't need to save it. But there are rats.
But I got a good initiative for once.
Thaddeus, if you want to act to do something about these rats, go for it.
No, I'm fine.
There's two of them and one from either side. They're going for the table.
All right, Mara. So, I know. Mara's gonna so Pinky's I'm trying to understand what happened. Pinky's brain glowed and then two more appeared? Or is
it from underneath the tablecloth? Like Harmony's magic flashed and two appeared.
Okay.
I'm curious if Yako stops himself from pouncing on the rat.
Are they Pinky though? Or are they not Pinky?
That's what I'm saying. I'm wondering. I'm wondering if Pinky can go over there and say, hey, back up. Yeah, I'll get you some food.
Do you want to try that?
Yeah.
See if they'll join Pinky.
So what do you tell Pinky to do?
When we notice them going up toward the table, after I notice Pinky's weird kind of brain cavity glow thing go, I say, hey, what's happening over there? Pinky, go check it out. Can you stop them from eating before we do?
And Pinky kind of in its slightly humanoid shape looks at you, and then the rats swarm towards the other rats. Let's see.
Be glad to get them some over there.
Pinky, you can see like a flash of psychic energy lash from Pinky's collective brain cavities towards the two cranium rats. And they just instantly stop what they're doing and kind of turn slowly towards Pinky. And then Pinky, with its like hand formed of rats, just kind of like with like a one of the fingers just gestures like, come here you. And the two rats kind of slowly climb down the table and crawl across the ground and then climb into the swarm that is Pinky.
That's great.
Now to repay the rat that we lost.
I was going to say that. Now we're plus one.
All right.
That's why I picked this one. So as part of Heroes Feast, you all get 13 hit point increase to your maximum hit points. They're not temporary hit points. It's a temporary increase to your maximum hit points. 13, and then you also recover 13 hit points as part of this. This lasts for the next 24 hours, I believe.
These benefits last for 24 hours.
Oh, yeah, there it is. Yep.
So they're temporary hit points?
No, if you go to your hit points box,
yeah.
Yeah. There's a max HP modifier.
Okay.
You just add 13 in there.
Yeah.
Yep.
Okay.
You also are cured of all diseases and poison, if that matters. You're immune to poison. You're immune to being frightened. And we make all wisdom saving throws with advantage for the next 24 hours.
Good to know.
So immunity to poison. Is it poison damage or being poisoned?
Immune to poison, it just says.
Yeah, I would say that's both poisoned and poison damage.
The condition and damage.
Okay. Okay. So immunity to poison, wisdom at advantage.
Immune to being frightened, which I think we get from Thaddeus' aura,
yeah,
too. But this but is even if we're outside the aura.
Yeah, or if I go down.
Okay, cool.
I have a question for the DM.
Yep.
Does the food taste good?
No, it does not.
Oh, no.
It looks good, but when you take a bite, it tastes like dirt and sand, and a little bit like rotten and moldy.
Can I try prestidigitation again? Does that...
Yeah, you cast that, and then by the time you're like raising, like you think the effect will take, and it probably does for about half a second, but then by the time you're raising the food to your mouth after casting the spell, it's already tasting disgusting again.
Damn.
Oh, dang.
Yeah, that's but really sad. The effects are conferred. So this is the saddest
heroes. If we can choke down all this sawdust, then we get great effects.
For an hour. It takes us an hour to consume.
Yeah, this is the saddest meal.
Do we still get drunk off of the alcohol, though?
Yeah, I mean, the alcohol all still works. It just tastes like...
Then I think we'll do that first, and then it doesn't matter what the food tastes like.
Yeah, it is, I mean, it's the worst hero's feast ever cast, but it works.
Best That's worst. It.
That checks out. Also, I realized... Now, after the fact that Tides of Chaos was primed, so wild magic would have triggered anyway, but it's funny that I ended up rolling one.
So
Does that mean it's still prime? No.
Okay. Now, we'll just say it double triggered.
So, your disgusting feast consumed, and its effects gained. Is there anything you want to do tonight or talk about? Or is it just pretty much straight
to bed? I'm sorry, you guys. I'll have to cast this again when we get home so we can actually enjoy it. This is
sounds good. Like something to look forward to.
It's not what I was expecting.
Best intentions.
So for Mephistopheles and Beelzebul, we're planning on meeting with them if this all goes right. Is that the case? Is that what you're thinking?
We're definitely going to meet with Beelzebul. I don't think we have any reason to meet with Mephistopheles.
All right. I mean, Hutagen in that case, but I don't know.
Or not him either.
Okay.
We'll just send a messenger, right?
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
So...
We don't really even have to be convincing when it comes to Beelzebul. All that needs to happen is that Beelzebul is seen to meet with us.
Yeah, sure. I see what you're saying. That's a good point.
But in order to do that, we need money?
Yeah.
How much money do we have?
Well... Let me see. I mean, we still have a decent amount. Because we didn't actually spend that much when we were in, what's its face? Sigil.
So how much do we have?
Somewhere
the answer to the question, though, the actual answer to the question we asked.
I mean, somewhere around like 50,000, I think.
And
it's quite a lot.
That's do we want to spend our own?
Huh?
Do we want to spend our own?
We could always spend it now and then replenish it later.
Yeah, we have to, right?
I guess.
Or are we rethinking doing that?
Moloch doesn't have any money because he's been bumming around with you guys for 5 years. So he's got nothing, unfortunately.
I see. I'm just wondering how he's paying the Bugalos to begin with.
Yeah, that's a question.
Yeah, okay.
Literally none of you know the answer to this. But
yeah, no, we haven't really thought about that.
I might just ask him because I'm very curious. He's like, I don't have money. I'm like, what? Like
last time you asked him, he told you that he did a favor for someone which earned him the allegiance for his errand, basically. The duration of this errand.
I see.
Which is why he was confident that the devils would have to bring a significant amount of money to buy them off.
And that's what they're trying to do.
That's what they're trying to do.
So, I mean,
at least.
Okay. Are we rethinking that strategy to get that treasure? What's it called?
I think that's on our list. Anyway, the question is just, are we going to do it before or after we try and meet with Beelzebul?
I mean, it'd be a good insurance to do it before, right?
Yeah.
So.
But right now, I think we're thinking about the hags.
I don't know if I'm really order dependent, but I see what you're saying. Depends on what we want to prioritize.
I don't know. I kind of
heading for a second. We're focusing on the hags because that's what Ethan has prepared.
I know what you're saying.
The two that I'm prepared for are dealing with Mephistopheles and Beelzebul and the hags.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
I have loose ideas about the other one, but if that's what you want to do next.
Well, this is why I want to use our money, send off the messengers, go deal with the hags, and then when we come back from dealing with the hags, we'll be able to proceed with our plan with Beelzebul. Right?
Well, one of the messengers is us. I mean, Moloch is saying that he has ways to get us an audience with Beelzebub.
So it would have to happen simultaneously, is what you're saying. There's no point in sending off a messenger now.
Right. So I'm cool just doing the hags and then talking about the word of the next two after that.
Then in that case, the hags, the treasure, and then the sabotage?
Yeah, it's fine.
Or maybe even not the sabotage. If because I looked at the list and something opens up when we get 10 points and the hags are going to get us to 10 points. So there might be other things we do instead of the sabotage.
Good point.
Yep. Sounds fine to me.
And I guess we're hunting some hags tomorrow.
Yeah.
What do you guys think about that dome? And how are we going to get through it? Obviously, I can just cast a spell magic at an eighth level. And
I mean, that's
asking
a lot, though, right?
But that's also my ninth level spell right off.
We don't want to do that. I don't think we want to do that.
Moloch said it sounded like we could get over it if we took
Lulu.
I don't know what that means.
Oh, he meant that they were having trouble getting close, but since Lulu's fast, you can probably just.
Yeah, he meant
quickly.
We could get past the frog.
The dome protects
the
above,
itself.
But yeah, you can get to the dome better than the other devils have had any luck.
I'm glad I understood that correctly because that's how my brain processed that information.
The brain.
I'm glad someone understood. Yep.
I wonder
brain.
What the dome.
Glowy brain.
What the dome is made of?
Well, I assume it's
magic.
Magical. Yeah. Am I the only one who can cast a spell magic with a wish?
It's
maybe
you're certainly only the only one who can do it with a wish.
Well, I mean,
I can cast a spell magic with the bow.
I can. Magic.
It's just on my spell list. I think I even have it prepared, or if I don't, I can prepare it.
Yeah, so maybe we try the spell magic.
I'd imagine that it. I'm gonna guess it wouldn't work, but we can try.
Spell magic. It's a roll, isn't it?
It's a roll.
Like
also.
Spell.
We might also consider that it's, we wouldn't need to.
If we're inside.
No, no, because like that is like knocks on the floor of the temple. It said, I can keep devils out of this temple, but if, you know, if an owlbear were to come along, my ward wouldn't keep it out. It's possible that the same rules work for whatever bubble that they've got protecting their thing. If they're keeping fiends out from whatever, with whatever ward they're using, then that just won't apply to us.
Yeah, I guess we'll have to go there and try and keep a few ideas and then just see what we're up against. So.
Exciting. I love the idea.
Muted. I'm muted.
Into a magical fortress.
It's okay. I'm observant, so I can read lips. I knew exactly what you were saying.
All right, what did I say?
Why don't you tell us so everyone else knows?
It was something about heroes' feet.
Yeah, no. Yeah, heroes' feet.
No, I think that it's too optimistic thinking to assume that they would not have prepared for us. I think that, you know, we're the whole reason most of these armies are here. Everyone knows we're coming, and everyone knows we're the heavy hitters. So
then
wall is probably going to be keeping us out in addition to whatever else they want.
It might just be like a defensive thing, like arrows and other spells and stuff like that. So kind of like what Quar had, I think. Something similar to that sort of wall.
Force.
So you just disintegrate it, Harmony. Just
I tried disintegrating it with my amulet. Like, that wouldn't use up any of my spell slots.
Yeah,
I think that's a good plan A. And if that doesn't work, I'll try dispel magic.
I can also do dispel
magic. And if that doesn't work, then what will
it If you feel like it could have worked, but you just didn't do it good enough, then I can also dispel magic.
All three of us.
And what, we just kill the hags? I mean, what do we do if one of them is Ronan? There's not really a way to save her, is there?
Well, I was just going to ask, in our amount of research, not that we focused on it, really. Well, I mean, maybe we did a little bit here and there. Is there any tells of hags turning back? Or redeeming them somehow?
I can't remember specifically the topics you researched into.
I know we looked for the sword, so like the blood war was a big research topic.
Yeah.
And then
I would say that Harmony, who was the main researcher? Was it Harmony or Zant?
I think it was me.
Okay.
And then Thaddeus sent somebody, or was it you? Oh, I'm sorry. What did I do?
I don't remember. One of us was hacks, one of us was devils, but I feel like we both researched a lot of shit.
Yeah.
And I can't remember who did what.
One of you, I guess, can just roll a retroactive arcana check if you want.
Yeah, go for it. Yeah, I'm sure not going to roll arcana.
I think it was Harmony 15. Who went to hags anyways.
That makes sense.
There's, like, the thing about hags in your research is there's a lot of stories about them, but they're all pretty, you know, different and each kind of weird in their own way. There's not really any, I mean, there's a lot of inconsistencies in the lore you find about them, basically. There might have been one or two legends about, you know, a knight who her, you know, younger sibling was born and then taken by a hag, and then she traveled, you know, here and there, and, you know, took on legendary quests and gained legendary items, and then eventually through incredible magical power, like, reverted the transformation. You know, like, this sort of legend might exist, but it's the stuff of legends rather than recorded fact, you know? That's the
wish problem. Level magic.
Yeah, I mean, if I have wish, but that's a big risk.
Yeah.
Because it's not any documented spell, it's making it up as I go. And you all know what happened the last time I did that.
Yeah, well,
if you're worried about Ronan, I would say you can always wish for her return after this is all over.
Well, I think the issue
is I have to be very careful about how I work.
The issue is that if we target the hags like we're planning to, we don't really have the opportunity to wait, right? Like, we're going there to stop them.
Yes.
We can't like take Ronan with us for a later time. At least I don't think that's really a good possibility.
Yeah, that's also true. So if we go, we're gonna have to kill her.
Yeah.
But
we're gonna have to grit our teeth and.
But it's not her anymore, in a way. I mean, right? She was eaten, and then.
Unless those legends are anything to believe, and there is a chance that it's possible.
I just don't.
She might maintain some of her previous self or something.
I mean,
she made comments, right? That like knowing comments when we, I thought we like heard Ronan's voice and like something like that.
There's certainly like bits of her that seem to remain. Like she had that kind of obsession with the unicorn stuffed animals. She seemed fixated on Harmony and Tal, you know, who both interacted with her when she was, Tal when she was like a baby and actually a human, but then Harmony later after she had been, you know, changed into a hag child. So there are bits, certainly, of Ronan's personality and individual persona that seem to remain. Even in her current state, you know, it's the kind of thing where, like, it might be possible. Probably the only thing in your toolbox is Harmony's wish spell, if this is something you wanted to pursue. The only other thing that might work is if you could find a way to, you know, detain her long enough that you could get, like, divine intervention. Like a god might be able to reverse the transformation. But yeah, as for the things that you have at your availability, I can't think of anything other than Harmony's wish spell that stands a chance.
Yeah, I can't either.
Personally. So.
Maybe our camping two characters can help out with this.
Yeah,
later. Well, way, way later. Characters. When they're level 20.
Oh.
No, we... We grab her and stuff her into the bag of holding for a while.
No, she would suffocate.
That would work.
She would suffocate, but there might be.
Or just.
Isn't there, like, what is it, like demiplane or something? We could shove her into a demiplane and leave her there until we.
Demiplane is a spell.
Am I thinking of the right one?
You are.
That's a spell.
Yeah. I could just shove her in there until we have access to. I mean, I've spoken to Zanihan once. She might owe me a favor. Just saying. After we get back to the material plane and deal with her mess.
Yeah, I don't know. I don't think we really have any good choices there. I think we have to.
I look very pointedly at Thaddeus. Can we at least
doing that a lot recently.
Try not to kill her immediately until we're absolutely sure there's no helping it?
Thaddeus shrugs and looks at you and says, I killed Dahlia. I'll kill Ronan too.
That's why I'm asking you, can you just not though? I know that you will if I don't say anything, so can you just at least try to restrain yourself?
I'll protect this party.
That's not the answer I was looking for.
It's the only answer I've got.
I take your drink from your hand and walk away.
It doesn't taste very good, Harmony.
Fine.
No more hero's taste for you. I'm going to go into a corner of the temple and I'm going to pull out the Ruby of Sending, which we have not used today, and I'm going to send a message to Seal.
Oh, okay. What do you say?
And I'm going to say, I need a favor. Can you find information about reverting the hag transformation? Thanks.
Okay. The message you get back is, oh, hello, my favorite little pink friend.
Don't waste all your words on that.
They have enough words, don't worry. They then say, I can understand why you would want information like that. I'll see what I can find. And you can hear at the end of the sentence just a very Seal-like kind of mischievous chuckle. And that's it. That's what you get back.
Awesome. I feel better.
I mean, I'm starting to doubt that. I know that we, out of character, I know that we asked Ethan to prepare this, but I'm starting to doubt, like, this is the correct order of operations if we're really trying to save Ronan. Because, like, we need a plan. We go in there and we have to just, you know, defend ourselves, really. Like, we're going into very hostile plays that we really can't.
We can scout it out first. Do what we can.
I mean, yeah. To run yeah, in we guns can. Blazing. I'm okay with that. I'm just thinking that once we're in the thick of it, like, we don't have good options to do anything else than stop them.
I'm with you.
I know, but non-lethal damage is a thing, and also demiplane is a thing, so. We don't have to figure out how to fix her right that second. I just want the chance to do it. And if that means that we have to kill her and down the line I have to use Wish to cast a spell like Raise Dead or Resurrection or something, then so be it.
I'll give you a chance. I promise I'll give you a chance. I mean...
I just want a chance to see if there's enough of her left in there to make it feasible, you know? Like, if it's very obvious that she is so far gone that there's nothing we can do, then whatever will kill her, that's fine. But it's a chance to right a wrong that I made a long time ago tonight, that we all made. Well, two of us here, at least.
Yeah, it would be good to, you know, be able to bring her home and
think about how much Alan helped us when we were in.
I'm not saying I don't want to do this. I'm just.
I know.
I'm at my wit's end, right? Like, there's nothing that I know that we can do right now aside from wishing this, which is very risky, and I don't want to go there.
Right.
So.
I'm not going to do that in the middle of the battle.
Yeah.
But maybe Seal will find something tonight. And if not, we'll just... I mean, we're good at thinking on our feet.
Sometimes, yeah.
Most of the time. I mean, you saw what I did at that prison. Like, come on.
At that prison.
You think I walked in with that plan?
Oh, the place that we were at? The fortress?
Yeah.
That was good.
Harmony is extremely confident tonight. Do you guys get that? I mean, she's going to ask favors from Asanahan, and wow.
She has hero's feet tonight.
Hero's feet.
Wow.
Tasty hero's feet.
She gave you your rat back and one for the road.
Right.
Yeah. Well, I don't know. Maybe we should just sleep on it. And maybe Seal will get back to us.
Yeah, who knows? I'm tired. Let's go to sleep.
Alright.
Yeah, my minus 30 HP, I'm hurting too.
Minus 30?
That's all I had. I lost 30 HP total from that thing. Yeah. That's what I meant.
That's, yeah, I lost one spell, 16.
One spell and like 30 HP.
I lost 16, but I also like used a lot of spells.
Thaddeus was like out, right? You smited the crap out of everything, I think.
Yeah. He tanked everything.
Yeah,
for us.
Thaddeus was huge MVP. Thaddeus and Harmony.
I was not the MVP. Harmony was MVP, but.
You guys like.
I mean, Mara also saved
Tali
from dropping into lava. So.
Yeah. But yeah, right. I'm just gonna take my long rest.
Yep, I'm ready for a long rest.
Okay. The group of you kind of go off and find your individual corners for a long rest. Harmony, as you're kind of sitting there, getting ready to sleep, your mind kind of still is mulling over, you know, Ronin and what's to be done there. And what Zant said is certainly true. If you go into battle and, you know, things are going down, it's possible there won't be an opportunity at that point. It might be too late then. But these are just the kind of thoughts that kind of plague you as you're mulling it over. Especially knowing that kind of you're the only one with any tool in the toolbox to do anything about it. So it really does, everything kind of falls to your shoulders and your decision.
No pressure.
Yeah, no pressure. So I think that's kind of a heavy thought to go to sleep with. Let me read one thing real quick before I say what happens next. Okay. What creatures do you choose to have the temple oppose, Thaddeus, on a regular basis? Is it just fiends?
Let me remember if I can do fiends or if it has to be more specific.
It says one or more of the following: celestials, elementals, fae, fiends, or undead.
Oh, fiends. Yeah, it's just fiends. And I don't let anybody, no exceptions for that. Okay.
All of you fall asleep. Do you have any kind of like watch rotation, or is it just?
I think I would vote that we would, or I would volunteer to do that.
I think
that.
Usually you do have kind of a watch rotation, even when you're in the temple. So
because it's hell.
What does that look like? I'll take first watch.
Okay.
Since my brain is kind of
roll a
busy.
Perception check.
Tides of chaos.
Yeah.
That was a natural one. It's not much better. Six.
Okay. The plane's lighting doesn't really change. It's just kind of always this dim, not really sunny, not really cloudy, just kind of like blah horizon, right? You don't really see or observe anything much during your watch, but you do hear the sounds of fighting continuing off in the distance. You think maybe you hear the sound of a large group of troops evacuating your camp and sort of moving towards the battlefield, as if maybe Ruin's troops are now ready to join the fray. But that's about it for you. Who's next? When do you wake up?
I can go next.
All right. I'll go over now. I'll wake up, Zant.
Okay.
And I'll say, I think Ruin's troops left.
Whose troops?
Ruin's troops.
Oh. I see.
Are you okay?
I guess. I mean, this is a pretty terrible place.
It is.
You know, I'm just waiting for it to be over.
Thank you for coming with me.
Of course.
You didn't.
How are you doing?
I've been better.
Yeah. It's... Big day.
Yeah, big week.
Big week.
Big 2 weeks. How long have you been here now?
Too long. You know, when you were saying that maybe we could, you know, meet your family and stuff, I didn't mean like Ruin. I meant more like your tribe. Something.
I didn't know Ruin was my family until we were fighting with.
I'm kidding.
With Mercer, and it just kind of came to me suddenly.
Yeah.
But, I mean, you met my mom.
Oh, yeah. That was before we got here, though.
Yeah, that's true. And not really, that wasn't really my decision either, but.
That's true.
And I don't really have any other family. I mean, my grandma's out there somewhere, but I haven't seen her in a really long time. I don't know.
I'm sure they'd be more friendly than this, though.
Yeah. Yeah, and if I took you to the tribe, like, I don't... They probably don't want to have anything to do with me, so... It might be similar to this.
I don't know. I definitely place my bets on them, their hospitality, than what we've been facing.
I don't know. That party was pretty cool.
That was pretty cool. We have a lot of things that we can brag about that probably no one else can.
Yeah. Too bad you don't remember most of the cool stuff on the fifth layer, though.
Yeah, that was unfortunate.
You were really cool. Can't believe you cut off his head.
Yeah, if only I was there to see it. Hey, Blitz. Well, I'm sure everything will be fine. We've made it this far. We can see it to the end.
I'm gonna
figure
something
out. Yeah, get some sleep.
Thanks, Zant.
Good night.
All right, Zant, perception check. Byakko kind of curls up with you and sleeps gently at your feet.
Oh, that's Byakko. Blitz Byakko. Oh, that's pretty good. That's a 27?
27. All right. You also hear the sounds of ongoing fighting constantly through your rest. Far off in the distance, it's nothing that you have to worry about. But at one point in the night, or if it is night, I mean, in your rest anyways, you begin to feel something. Which for a little bit you had not been feeling, which is that sort of sense of dread. Like with Thaddeus around, it never progressed fully to, and I guess since you have the Heroes Feast, it still doesn't progress this far. But that's that kind of like tingling.
Like we're being chased or whatever? Or...
Like you're being pursued by something. That sort of primal, not fear necessarily, but like flight instinct. Okay. Yeah, you begin to feel that, and just as it's starting to get on your nerves, you hear a loud boom from far, far away. But it echoes across the landscape, and probably all of you would be awakened by this just briefly. But Zant is probably the only one who sees it. There is this flash of light, like a big flash of like bright white light off in the distance that kind of consumes the sky. And it blooms out in a massive radius. And then it persists for about a second and then disappears. And that's all you see.
What was it? What can I make of this thing? Is it just a bomb or was it like does it leave like a crater where it boomed?
Well, it's far in the distance. You wouldn't be able to, like, you might, even if you flew up, you'd have to fly pretty high in the air to be able to see anything.
Okay.
So yeah, it's a little unclear, but it's probably someone managed to detonate that big bomb. Where it was, on your side, their side, you don't know yet.
I see.
That's what happens during your shift.
Well, nothing to panic about, guys. We almost just died.
Well, as long as I'm awake.
Yeah.
And I'll take third watch.
Okay. Sure. That's enough excitement for me tonight.
Thaddeus, you also feel that sort of, you know, prickling dread. It starts with the adrenaline from when you woke up and it just persists. Go ahead and make your perception check.
I'm not saying, but I got a natural 20. That's 22.
There it is.
22, okay. Other than the sounds of fighting far in the distance, let me see something. Okay. It gets to be maybe about just towards the end of your shift, maybe the last hour or so of this rest. Everyone else is still asleep. But it's probably about time to go wake them up for the day ahead of you soon. When you hear from outside the walls of the temple, just a slow, and they're quiet, but with your perception check, your heightened senses of awareness, you hear something prowling around the walls of the fortress. What do you want to do? You've got probably, what do you want to do?
Can I look out the window?
Are there windows in the walls? Yeah.
Yeah.
You run to look out the window.
I don't know how else we would have seen that bomb flash.
Just like over the walls, because it was high into the sky. It was massive.
Isn't this like a roofed?
I think it does have a roof.
Oh, I thought it was like an open area.
Let me check Temple of the Gods.
The interior is an open space. Yeah, yeah. So you would have seen it through windows, I suppose.
Yeah.
So you run to those windows and...
as many windows as you wish. There you go.
Yeah. How many windows do you wish?
50.
It's eight.
Eight. Perfect. It is a good number. You run to the window and you see prowling outside pretty close to the window such that you nearly come face to face with it as you look out. A large creature, maybe 15 feet long and probably 8 or 9 feet at the shoulder. It has the form of a great hound, just a massive dog, but it is this metallic construct of, it's constructed of dark steel infernal plates. And you can see that under those plates, there is a broiling inferno. And as this creature turns its head towards you and its burning eyes meet your gaze, it puts one paw up on the wall of the temple and begins to climb. How tall are the walls of this temple anyways?
Fit, and I'm not caught up to 120 feet on each side. I don't think the walls are 120 feet. I think the walls are probably like 40 feet.
Okay. Yeah, it begins to climb up onto the thing. And as you look out the window, you can see another one of these creatures climbing up on the other side. What would you like to do?
I'm going to start saying my prayers, preparing my spells.
Okay. You probably have enough time to do that before there begins to come a crashing sound from the ceiling of the temple. And pieces of it are torn open. And all of you at this point hear this and wake up. Zant, I don't know, do you sleep in your armor?
You're a rough. Probably, I mean, given the place, I don't know, is Thaddeus sleeping in his armor?
I would have probably donned mine as part of my watch.
Yeah, I think as part of your watch, I'm just mostly curious about Zant.
Probably
Zant
not then.
Okay. Well, these dog-like faces emerge over this hole they've torn in the ceiling. And with a heavy thud, they leap down into the open temple space. And I think we need to roll initiative.
I think it's fair for you to be in armor. You're like, Thaddeus would have woken
you up. Slept in the armor because of where we are.
You need to be prepared.
Yeah, I'm fine either way. It's up to you. I don't think it's metagaming to say you were in armor, considering you're in hell.
I mean, I sleep in my robe, but that's not really armor.
Your robe's a bit more cozy.
Yeah. And they can have cactus needles to defend you.
Yeah, I don't think I woke the other two up because I didn't realize they would be breaking through the ceiling, but also
the sound of the ceiling breaking woke us up.
Yeah.
So everyone is awake. Since Thaddeus didn't wake anyone up, I think Zant is probably the only one with like a high enough passive perception to act the first round, Thaddeus and Zant.
Sure.
Let's roll initiative. We certainly won't finish this, but we can start something.
I wonder if these are the things that have been chasing us.
I hope
they leap down into the ground, that sort of feeling certainly intensifies around you. So it seems likely.
I would hate for there to be a different thing that was chasing us that was not this.
Yeah, me too.
So I assume this means we did not get the benefit of a long rest.
No, I mean, it was right at the end of your long rest, so I would say you could if you wanted to.
Okay, good.
I'll leave it up to you to decide, because the thing is, any resources you spend now, you don't have later for missions. But if you want to, so I'll let you decide whether you'd want to have a rest or not.
But I feel like we all need to do the same thing, right?
But I will let you decide as a group.
But if Thaddeus is preparing new spells, I feel like that's a new day at the end of a long rest, right?
It definitely is for Thaddeus, because he took third watch. He got his long rest.
That's true.
You know?
Right, so I feel like it would have to count for everybody.
Yeah.
If one person's going to have the long rest, I feel like we all need to have it, right?
Yeah.
It's fine. What do you guys want to do?
Okay. All right, I'm taking it.
Okay. Sounds like it's a long rest then.
Sure. I rolled a Thaddeus initiative.
I rolled worse, I assure you.
What
did Thaddeus get?
Thaddeus got an 8.
8. And then Harmony?
7.
7. Zant?
5.
5.
With
Mara.
Advantage.
Looking at Melissa, rolling her eyes here.
29.
18.
Oh, 16. Oh, wow. Okay. Not in the 20s for once.
And then Byakko?
Byakko got an 18.
That's the furthest away from your initiative, I think.
Yeah, we're normally like right there. Yeah. It's very strange now. I don't know what I'm going to do.
These creatures act first.
Of course.
And they leap down to the ground. Everyone is kind of still trying to get up out of their sleeping, their bedrolls and things like that. Oh boy, I built these monsters a while back. What can they do? Who's sleeping near other people, or is everyone pretty spread out?
I'm off in a corner by myself.
Oh, you said that. I remember.
Yeah.
So
pretty much.
I would have moved in a position to at least give the two sleepers my aura.
So everyone is pretty well spread out then. One of them will turn towards, we'll say, Harmony and Zant. The two of you, I think, would be within a cone, since this cone is big. And I need each of you to make a dexterity save as this creature opens its mouth and an inferno erupts out of it.
Is this a fiend?
No.
Is this a magical effect?
It is a magical effect, yes.
Not a fiend, huh?
And you get your plus 5 from my aura.
All right. I got...
Two very good rolls.
Go ahead.
Sorry, you said dex?
Mm-hmm.
26.
Okay, that's a pass.
21.
And then 21 is also a pass. And then make one for Byakko as well, because I guess Byakko would be with you.
Higher than 21. Okay.
So everyone takes 31 points of fire damage. Harmony, you take 15 because you have the fire damage. As this inferno just washes over you.
I'm going to use absorb elements.
Cool. So that's also 15 for you.
Okay.
The other one, I think, rushes to Thaddeus. Its eyes flash as it is running towards you, and you can feel sort of a magical effect settle on you, like that feeling of being hunted intensifies as it, requiring no components, so it can't be counterspelled, casts Hunter's Mark on you.
Oh, okay.
And then it will make 3 attacks.
I wouldn't have counterspelled that anyway. So there.
So, 1d6 extra when I hit with a weapon attack. Okay, that works.
What was the name of the spell? Sorry.
Hunter's Mark.
It's my mark.
19 to hit with the bite.
Who?
And then
Thaddeus Mark.
Zant's Mark.
26 to hit with a claw.
That'll hit.
And not great. 16 to hit with the other claw. So only one claw hits.
That's a really convenient spread, because I didn't have to use shields for any reason for any of that.
Yeah. There's my d6. So it does 17 points of damage as it slashes into you with its claw.
Okay.
Okay. That's both of them. Byakko is next.
All right. Byakko is going to... So if he's kind of... So I take it we're not using the map at all.
No, yeah.
Okay. So, Byakko, if he cone attacked us, is he in this creature's threat range, or did he have to stand back a little bit to fit us all in?
He had to stand back to fit you all in, so Byakko could get his run up.
Byakko is going to do that without provoking an opportunity attack then. Come on, Byakko, you got this. Maybe you got this. That is a 17 to hit? No, sorry, wait, 22 to hit. I don't know what I was looking at.
22, yes, Byakko's magical claws rake into this thing.
And it has to make a DC 18 strength saving throw or be knocked prone.
Let's
pass. Then he takes 16 damage from the claws. And that's Byakko's turn.
Okay. Mara, you are surprised for this round because you don't have Xant and Byakko level perception. Thaddeus, you have one of these things right up next to you.
Before I take my turn, I want to make sure Mara doesn't have any class features that don't let her be surprised.
That's a good question.
Some
monks
classes
do. Wait, no,
I don't know.
Not that I know of, actually.
Okay.
I haven't read anything like that.
Okay. Then. Yeah, I guess which one's closer to me?
The one that ran directly up to you and started attacking you with its bite and its claws.
Yeah, true. Yeah, I will. Yeah, I'll make two attacks against it. These are pretty. I already know these aren't fiends because they broke into my temple.
Mm-hmm. They're clearly not fiends.
Yeah. I got a nat 20.
Ooh, there it is.
Wow, that's two.
Oh,
and the other one was a 27 to hit.
I'm so excited for this.
Well, both of those.
I love it when you get crits.
Me too.
Oh man.
I don't know if I'm gonna go all the way with it though. I think I'm gonna use a third level smite here, not a fourth.
Just waiting to hear those sweet dice.
Sorry, my phone's acting up. Okay.
While he works on that, I looked at the rogue and...
Yes, please do something.
apparently, no attacks have advantage against Mara, ever.
Yeah, that's
unless
my elusive.
She's incapacitated. That's
says
cool.
Who.
But it doesn't say anything about not being able to be surprised.
I'm going to forget that, though, so people please remind me.
Yeah, I don't think that that's ever come up.
Well, that's my elusive, and I just got it not very long ago.
It's an 18th level thing. So you've had it at least for
so it's just like
levels.
You with the...
It's like me with my other thing that I forgot that I had. Yeah.
What level 18 thing did I get and forget about?
I knew
about?
I had elusive, but how do you know from a DM perspective, I'm not the DM.
That's true.
So how do
he
I know
always...
he's rolling advantage?
You just have
so...
to remind him, basically, I think.
But that's the thing. Like, how do we know when to remind him? Because he doesn't tell
yeah.
us necessarily
yeah,
every time he rolls
advantage. I usually
advantage
do when I'm
us.
Rolling at advantage, say it. Anyways, but I will try to make sure I say it every time. How did you do, Thaddeus?
I haven't even rolled yet. I have to ask you. These are not... I don't know they're not fiends. They're not undead, fey, or spirits, are they?
Nope.
Okay. Then I don't get this extra die.
I'm sorry, are there two of them
there
with multiple
them.
Heads each?
No, each one has one head.
Okay, so they're just big robot dogs.
Big metal dogs, yep, with like fiery insides.
Cool. Wait, how big are they?
Like 15 feet long and maybe 8 feet at the shoulder.
Mm-hmm. All right, not that big.
Pretty big.
Bigger than Harmony, for sure.
Are they immune to fire? Probably.
Like five times, sure.
Then my attack is going to have fire.
So,
I was expecting them to be like 20 feet tall. So
that's 66 for the first hit.
Oh, nice.
I don't have to separate the slashing from the radiant, do I?
Nope.
Okay. Then for the second hit, it's going to be a lot less. Various reasons. see. Yeah, I think its second one is just 2d8. So that's 14 damage on the second hit.
Okay.
I'm a lot less good at fighting everything else than fiends.
It definitely snarls at you as you slash into it with Moonrise, though. It doesn't seem to like that. Harmony, you are also surprised, unless you've got something that makes it so you're not.
An exclamation mark over her head.
I don't think that I have anything.
Okay, I will flank the one that Byakko pounced on so that we're not in a good cone for it and we have to reposition. I can't find a way to get advantage on my roll for this. So here we go. What does that mean, guys? I don't know what happens when you roll an attack without advantage. It's all right, well, here we go. So we're going to make some attacks with Kusanagi.
Welcome to the real world,
I don't like it. I'm leaving
poor sweet summer child.
Yeah, this isn't good. It's a 20 to hit.
That is enough, I think. Yep.
All right. I'm going to make this one a trip attack. So it has to make what's my thing? 20, DC 20, strength save.
Would you know? That's a failure. It falls prone.
So it's prone. Now I get advantage. Nice. Here we go. This is what I was looking for.
He finds a way.
I found a way, guys. And then I'm going to make, I guess, two more attacks. Do you want me to do one at a time, or do you want me to do them all together? Do you care?
The damage? Or
yeah.
The attacks?
You the can attacks do them and the damage.
At the same time. That's fine.
Okay. It's a crit.
Okay.
I'm going to roll again. Oh, come on.
Yes.
It's a 19! No! Oh. Dang it! Oh, dang it! Oh, so close. Okay, third attack. That's a 24 to hit.
Yeah, definitely.
Alright, I always have to read the extra damage I get on crits with this thing. Byakko is also... I'm going to use coordinated attack, so he gets an attack as well, but I'll do Zant's damage first. Let me see. I get... It's 1d8 for these. Okay. So, that is exactly average. I got 4 fours out of 8. So that is 8, 16 plus, what is this? They're not fiends.
I forgot to roll for Pinky. Can we put him in last, or is it too late?
Pinky would have also been surprised. We can put him in next. Or if you want to roll initiative for him now, go for it.
And then... 37 plus, what is this? Is it 14? Yeah. It is 51. So 51
total?
Plus 1d10. 55 for all of my attacks. And then Byakko's attack is a 24 to hit.
Yeah, I mean, yep, that'll do it.
And it is boop, 12 damage.
Okay.
And that is my turn.
Alrighty. What did Pinky get for initiative?
17.
Okay. Oh, I'm supposed to add fire damage to this too. Does it do anything?
It does nothing. Okay, the fire from the attacks just rolls over the creature's heavy armor.
Okay,
nothing.
That's why I didn't even bother.
And that is the end of the first round of combat. So I think we'll finish... this bit up next time and see where we go from there. Sound good?
Yep.
All right. Thank you guys for playing, as always.
Yeah,
thank you to everyone who tuned in to watch. We will pick this up, this combat with these construct hellhounds, next time on Anti-Heroes Anonymous. So hope to see you then. Bye.
Bye.